What's going on, guys? Welcome to the Peanut Gallery Podcast, episode 18. Seth, how you doing, man?
We are legal now.
We are legal. We are a legal podcast. We give consent for you to listen to us.
See, there you go.
That's how that works. Oh, man. I got to warn you, I'm a little tired today, so if I start, like...
You haven't done anything all week, bro.
If you guys see me, like, starting to fall asleep, it's probably just because I'm bored of listening to Seth talk, so... This is the Peanut Gallery Podcast, guys. Of course, this is the place that we provide our completely unprofessional and insignificant opinions on the most important and significant topics of the day. I'm your host, Jared, and with me, as always, is Seth, and we are going to jump right into the What Was Nuts This Week.
Why are you so mean to me?
All right, guys, we're going to jump right into what was nuts this week, and we're going to start out with this first story with the Fourth Court of Appeals has upheld a Maryland assault rifle gun ban.
So, yeah, the mythical assault rifle,
and the deadly black AR-15.
Wait, it's not an assault rifle. It's an assault weapon, right? Because an assault rifle would actually be a thing.
Well, they call it... Well, they're all assault weapons if they have large-capacity magazines that are actually standard-capacity magazines for the rifle, but they're large capacity because they hold a lot of rounds to them.
A large amount, some would say?
A large amount.
All right, anyway, this really bothers me because what they said was that the Second Amendment does not cover or allow citizens to own assault weapons.
Military-style assault weapons. You got to get that other buzzword in there. You have to get that other one in there.
Yeah, I forgot.
Yeah. So basically, it's interesting because this court ruling held up a previous Supreme Court, the Heller case, which was kind of a famous case where the Supreme Court ruled that the Second Amendment does protect these weapons, and it talked about how under some circumstances, M16s could be banned. For anyone who doesn't know, M16 is a fully automatic military service rifle. So it's fully automatic.
An actual
military rifle. And what they did, what the Fourth Court of Appeals did, is they compared the AR-15 to the M16, which, while they might look similar, they're completely different in functionality.
Well, I mean, it's understandable slightly.
If you're an idiot. But,
well, I mean, I wasn't going to come out and say it, but I mean, it does, it has the same look. If you were just to quickly look by, you could assume they were the same thing, but
these are federal judges, man. It drives me insane. If you're just speaking out about it, like you're on TV and you don't really know and you want to talk about it, that's one thing. I still think that's dumb. But if you're a federal judge who has the potential to change law on a certain subject, you better freaking know what you're talking about. And to say that its operations, a single-shot weapon, a semi-automatic weapon, has the same operation or is a military-style weapon like a fully automatic M16 is insanity.
It's a little different.
It's a little dumb.
Yeah.
A lot of dumb.
Another thing that bothered me is that they cited the fact that the fire rates were similar. Like, are you kidding me?
Yeah, and so, you know, just a quick Google search. Anybody could find this out. An AR-15 has a fire rate of 45 rounds per minute. And M16, it's pretty similar. You know, I mean, you know, M16s just have, you know, 700 to 900 rounds per minute. So it's about 45.
Yeah, close. I mean, what they did cite, though, and I think this could be where they... Well, maybe not, though, because they talked about how quickly a magazine could be emptied,
yeah.
And so that's just 30 rounds. Maybe they were even
rounds
citing a 10
five
round
seconds.
Mag. What?
Yeah. Well, yeah. Well, the article says
we don't even
says,
know what size they were talking about.
That's true. It doesn't specify, but you would assume it's a standard issued. Let's just assume for the purpose of this that it's a standard issue round. That's 30 rounds in 5 seconds. You can't do that with a semi-automatic rifle. Like that would be pulling. That would be pulling the trigger like 3 times every second. 6 times every second.
Yeah.
That's impossible.
I don't know the math. I'm not a math guy.
That is impossible to do.
Okay. Yeah, just the reset of the trigger. Anyway.
Typically, people shoot about a bullet a second. But anyways, yeah, like you said, this is it's completely false. And Seth and I are very passionate about the Second Amendment.
Yes.
We're both very passionate about this. So we're actually going to do an entire 4-part series on the Second Amendment, and we're going to be putting that out later.
Yeah, so we're not going to get too much into it, but this thing, I think, is completely dumb. I think it has no basis to say the Second Amendment doesn't make any distinction on the type of weaponry that it covers and doesn't cover. Sorry, it doesn't.
It doesn't.
And we're going to get into that. We're going to get to the amendment. We're going to get into the
history of why it was ratified and created.
Yeah, so just be looking forward to that video. That'll be coming up shortly.
Yeah, definitely. So this next story, this is honestly, man, these stories that keep coming out, this is about Jeff Sessions and kind of the whole debacle that's been surrounding him the past week. These are really making – it's a lot of smoke but not that much fire. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So
it doesn't
seem like
it's as big of a deal as it's being made out.
No, it's not. But it's – when there's a ton of the smoke and stuff that's always happening around the Trump administration, it just kind of further perpetuates the narrative that – it's unorganized and they don't really know what they're doing and they're amateur and stuff like that. And you can make an argument for that, honestly, with all of this stuff that's happening.
Mm-hmm.
So if you don't know, so basically Jeff Sessions decides to recuse himself from any kind of an investigation that the Department of Justice would do into Russian intervention of the election of 2016.
Yes. Well, he had said that he hadn't talked to Russia. Also, he had said that he hadn't spoke with Russia at all, and then it came, like, before the election, then it came out that he did, but then he's citing the fact that he said he hadn't spoken to Russia about the election.
Yeah.
And so there's no proof at this moment that he spoke about those things. So the fact that he just spoke with Russia isn't an issue. It would be an issue if
they spoke
about to
the
them
election.
About the election or whatever.
And he was a senator at the time. It's not unusual for senators to speak with the Russian ambassador.
Well, we're seeing senators come out and saying, well, I've never spoken to that at all, and I've never done this. And you have another senators come up forward and saying, yeah, I do it all the time.
Yeah, Chuck Schumer, the Senate minority leader, is one of the prominent ones who's calling for Jeff Sessions' resignation, and he's spoken to the Russian ambassador in recent years. So it's just it's kind of ridiculous. It is wrong. I mean, I think that the decision for him to kind of recuse himself from the investigation, I think that was probably a good decision.
Yeah.
One, because it's just going to go to the deputy attorney general, which is someone who, like, he basically appoints and approves of. So they're going to rule similarly as he would anyways. Mm-hmm. But also, I think it would make sense for him to just come out and say, look, we didn't talk about the elections. Nothing, bad happened, but I'm just going to go ahead and recuse myself of it anyways, just to totally, put everything under the rug. Everything's fine.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? Just to kind of snuff out any kind of fire that would come up.
Yeah.
But the problem is that the Trump administration doesn't communicate with each other, because then you have Donald Trump and Paul Ryan saying, no, he shouldn't have recused himself at all. This is ridiculous. It would have been smart if they had all just said the same thing. No, he didn't do anything wrong, but we're going to go ahead and do it anyways, just in, an effort to maintain a level of fairness. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
I think that would have been
some
smarter,
cohesiveness
in
the administration.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. Like we said, I don't think it's necessarily grounds for him to have to do it.
I think there needs to be an investigation. I think that we need to figure out if he did or did not speak about it. But at this point, I think getting all up in arms is a little premature.
And calling for his resignation? I mean, come on.
It's like the
newest
buzzword.
He spoke with the
Russian
ambassador.
Resign, impeach.
Resign, impeach. There's always something to be up in flames about.
But okay, the next story is something I think everyone can get on board with. Except for maybe the very few bad cops. A new holster that's being developed, it's actually a sensor that goes into the holster. But what it does is every time a gun is drawn, it automatically sets all of the body cams of the surrounding police officers to turn on and start recording.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, there's a big outcry. Certain cities have mandated every police officer has body cams. Other cities want this. I personally think it's a great idea. I don't think there's any situation where a police officer should be doing something that they don't want on video.
Mm-hmm.
That's just my
Well, that's why thought. That's why police vehicles have cameras on them too,
yeah,
so you can see it. And I think this would help the police officers honestly, because, you know, the majority of the time, yes, there's cases where police officers mess up and there's bad cops out there. But I think the majority of the time, cops aren't going around abusing people and messing up and stuff. So yeah, I think if there's always video of these kind of actions and stuff taking place, I don't have a problem.
And it also, I think, can kind of get rid of the whole, oh, they stopped working or we forgot to turn them on. Yeah. Every time the gun's drawn, they all turn on. Like, that's, I think that's awesome. And so it's cool to see this is the same company that's doing this, Signal Sidearm. They do a lot of the body cameras, so they kind of already have an in, and so to have the sensor talk to the body cameras isn't that wouldn't be that hard. And so I think this is a cool idea, and it's cheap.
Yeah, they talked about it being relatively inexpensive too, because you don't have to. It works with the holsters that are already kind of standard issue for police officers.
And so I don't think there's any really cons to this. I think it's
a
good idea.
No, I don't have a problem with it. I think it's pretty cool. This next thing too, I think, is also pretty cool. We got YouTube TV coming up
announced. This is actually pretty cool. As we all know, traditional cable services are kind of dying.
I don't even have I just have Wi-Fi, man, and I just stream it.
With people cutting the cords and only going internet and streaming all their shows or whatever, YouTube just unveiled their YouTube TV program, which is where for $35 a month you can subscribe to, like, subscribe on YouTube. You subscribe to channels you want to see content from. So you can subscribe to channels like ABC, CBS, Fox, NBC. Right now it's up to 35 channels. Not a lot, but the idea is that it will grow. And so in this way, you can watch your favorite shows in the YouTube interface. And if you subscribe to them, whenever the show runs, it automatically records it and sets it, and it has unlimited cloud storage, so that's cool.
Yeah, that's really cool.
I mean, I think this is great. This is,
and plus, it's a little bit cheaper too than, like, you know, DirecTV or satellite or Dish.
Not only is it cheaper, but you can have up to 3 streams going at a time on this for $35. That's pretty good.
Yeah.
And then in addition to paying for those basic channels, you can also pay for what channels you want in addition to that. And so that's cool. Like, you get what you want. You don't get any extra crap. Because a lot of these bundles, you'll get, like, from Comcast and stuff, you get, like, thousands of channels. You're not going to watch the majority of them. And so just pay for the ones you want. I think this is great. Also puts a little bit of pressure on cable providers to maybe offer better deals. I think this is great all around.
It's a great thing right there. It's a great thing.
Snuff them out.
Yeah, no, I think that's cool. Does YouTube... Okay, so we're talking about this next story. We're talking about Amazon's servers and stuff like that. We were talking about this before we started recording, how Netflix rents basically their servers from Amazon, or Amazon owns them.
So,
and sells out.
If you were on the internet at all a couple of days ago, you might have felt some issues navigating certain web pages, or there could have been some, like, crashes and stuff. And so what happened was Amazon has a cloud. It's a storage solution, servers that host content for the internet. They're basically giant server farms that hold massive amounts of data, and a lot of websites and stuff rent space from them to host stuff on the internet. So if, say, for instance, a show on Netflix like The Office, there needs to be a file somewhere that is streamed to you. And so that file would exist theoretically on one of these servers. Netflix was one of the websites affected by this outage. They were having massive failure rates and a lot of issues for about 5 hours or so. And so a lot of the internet kind of crumbled for a while. And it's kind of crazy because just one company has so much – they hold up so much of what we think of the internet that you really don't realize that, like, even if, for instance, if it was a malicious attack and they took them down, I mean, that would be places like Netflix, Spotify, if you're in the business world, Slack,
Pinterest,
that.
Man, I couldn't get on my Pinterest account.
You could not get on Pinterest.
Gosh, man, I couldn't look at all the delicious recipes, you know,
dude,
that
I love
totally
Pinterest,
have
man.
All
Pinterest
over my
is
Pinterest.
Legit. Some dope guns on Pinterest. Anyway, it was cool, and I think it's a nice I mean, most people probably just, oh, my web page isn't loading, my router's down. They probably didn't think too far into it.
Because it was fixed within a relatively
fixed within a couple hours. But it's an interesting reminder that, like, this stuff isn't as concrete as you might think. I mean, everything's prone to failure. And
I think anyone has experienced the internet before, it's definitely prone to failure. It's not 100%
proof. A little bit. Speaking of failure, the next story is about two people that fail 100% as parents.
Yeah, no, this story is crazy, man. When I read this article and this headline. Anyways, okay, so it's about these parents. What, they're religious parents, I guess.
Yes.
They claim, are they claiming that they're Christians?
I did not see a name.
It just said religious.
Yeah, religious.
So
parents.
Basically, they refused to treat their son and take him to the hospital for treatment that he desperately needed. Do you remember what disease it was that he had? He had a disease that kept reoccurring and coming up that he specifically needed
diabetes
treatment for. And it was like it was a severe case, and yes, they didn't treat him at all. He didn't have enough insulin levels. They wouldn't, yes, give him any injections for that at all, because they thought that, you know, God would heal him and stuff like, yeah, that.
They thought
that he would be
resurrected,
even though he wasn't dead yet. So they were planning on him to die.
They thought when he died that they were so good that he'd be resurrected. Are you kidding me?
I hate people, man.
I know,
like,
right?
This is ridiculous. We've talked about this before. We both believe. We're both Christians and stuff like that. So, you know,
yeah,
I believe in you know, the healing power of Jesus and stuff like that. But I also believe in doctors and medicine. And I believe in people's abilities to heal people with penicillin.
Well, not even penicillin. I mean, they start.
Well, anything. You know what I mean? Like, I believe in doctors healing people.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And it's insane that you think that, okay, I'll just let my kid die and then he'll be resurrected as healthy.
Yeah, it's a disturbing story. And
and they got charged with first-degree murder for it, right?
Thank freaking goodness.
Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, these people are clearly – they're clearly insane.
Oh, yeah.
Really. I mean, they definitely have mental problems. And the fact that they would just let their son die and think that he's going to be resurrected – it's,
yes,
crazy.
And, I mean, the prosecutor said that this likely took place over several months, maybe even years, with the kids slowly dying and them not giving him help.
And they wouldn't give him, like, enough food either.
No.
Starvation
and diabetes.
He weighed under 50 pounds.
It was, yeah, sad.
Yeah, super sad, super disturbing.
Yes.
That was a positive one. Thanks for putting that in
there. The next one's freaking great, man.
Thanks a lot, man. Way to sound like a druggie.
All right, so the next story that we're going to talk about, it's kind of two parts. I'll start with the first part, and then we'll lead in the second part. Last week, Vanity Fair did a little skit thing with Emma Watson, where a guy was walking around Central Station. Is that the big?
Yeah.
Yeah, Central Station in New York. With an iPad with Emma Watson on the iPad. She was somewhere else. And people could walk up and donate $2 and talk to her, ask her any question she wanted. I thought that was freaking cool.
It's a cool idea.
Yeah, it's a great idea. You can see a clip of it right here.
This is Derek Does Stuff with a Friend. Today's friend is Emma Watson. Welcome to the Emma Watson Advice Booth.
Derek Does Stuff with a Friend.
Advice from Emma Watson. Anyone? Hello.
Okay.
Hello.
How do I tell my friends that my wife and I are expecting our first child? It's a pretty good
That's
one.
That's so exciting. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Really freak them out. I feel like there's something very important that I really need to talk to you about, and it's very serious. Really lower their expectations. They're not excited. And then we're having a baby. And then I'll be like, that's freaking awesome.
Thank you.
Have a good one.
Congratulations.
All right, guys, who's got $2 and a question for Emma?
All right, so that was pretty cool, right? And then at the end, she said, let's donate all the money to Planned Parenthood. I mean, I wouldn't have done that, but she's allowed. I mean, she can do whatever she wants with it. That's fine. So she donates that money to Planned Parenthood. I would think a pro-feminist thing. She's also was at the Women's March. She flew in with her mom at the Women's March to help march with them. I would say a pro-modern-day feminist thing. She's actually spoken out about her feminist values, and she is an ambassador to the UN for some kind of public relations type of thing. She's spoken to the – I think – is it the UN, right? About
– sounds like a solid feminist in,
right,
today.
And,
yeah,
someone that, like, is definitely wanting to help that movement. Except apparently not, because she also did a photo shoot with Vanity Fair, and this picture – was one of the pictures taken, and it caused a meltdown of feminists. She started immediately getting attacked by feminists saying, oh my gosh, I can't believe you would pose like this. You're not a real feminist. You're such a hypocrite.
People, I love when they attack each other.
It's so great to see how quickly they fall apart and start infighting. Holy crap. you would just think feminism, wanting women to be empowered, that she, if she wanted to do this, that should be all power to her, right? Like, if you want to pose like this, go for it. That's showing that you're empowered and you're cool with it. Like, that's you being empowered. Apparently not. Apparently being good looking and just being confident in your body is anti-feminism.
They're not on the same page.
I don't understand. And while I'm not totally on board with all the stuff the feminists are on board, modern day feminism is on board with, it was really nice to see. And I did feel bad for Emma Watson, because I like Emma Watson as an actress. Yeah.
Yes.
But it was just like so nice to just see them start fighting each other quickly. And I know that might be bad to see people fighting, but it kind of just shows how fragile their belief system is and how...
Because they don't have any solid belief system. It's right? all subject to change. And the outrage culture, too. I love it, man. I love when they flip out on each other.
Right? And it wasn't even like that was the one... Like, she did one picture and that was it. Like, there was tens and 20s, 30s, 40s of pictures. Tons of pictures. And this was just the one they had issue with.
Yeah.
And then they just immediately attack her. And apparently... Everything else she's done for feminism doesn't matter because she took a picture without a bra on, and that's apparently the worst thing in the world.
Well, to these people, when you're a professional victim and you can be outraged about anything and offended by anything,
this is true.
This is the worst thing in the world. The world is literally ending.
Literally ending.
This next story, this is pretty interesting. So what is this? Where did the story come from? Fox Now?
Fox Now, yep. As you guys may or may not know, states throughout America are slowly legalizing marijuana. It at least seems that way. We have Washington, Colorado, California, Florida just legalized medication, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, not recreational use.
No, not recreational. But anyway, with this, a lot of people are saying that like this is going to bring in a lot of money into the states that legalize it, and it already has in Colorado. It's brought billions of dollars into the system. But also now there's a report now that estimates over the next 3 years, assuming legalization continues, legalized marijuana could create up to 300,000 jobs. And that will actually outpace manufacturing jobs created. And so I think that's actually really cool. I mean, I think it's kind of premature to say it will do this because, I mean, you're going to have automation of manufacturing marijuana, definitely. I am sure, picking, pruning, all that. Well, I mean,
there'll be businesses that create, you know, more efficient ways of doing those things.
But the fact that there's it's a good way, I think, to get jobs. I mean, I think it should be legal. I don't think there's any reason that it's illegal. I think it's cool to just looking at new ways for jobs to get created.
Yeah, so. I think we're definitely moving in that direction. I mean, the federal government doesn't even enforce.
Well, I mean, they have said they want to crack down on recreational marijuana.
They say
a
lot of things. We'll see what happens.
We shall see.
I don't think you can really do that now that Colorado's created, 20,000 jobs?
Yeah.
I mean, it would be political suicide for Donald Trump to go in and do that.
It would actually be beneficial for him to push the legalization if it can create this many jobs.
Yeah,
bigger pie that he could talk about with jobs created.
I think the federal government should be completely out of this issue. I think it should definitely be state decided, as most things should be, in my opinion. But no, that's crazy that if you think about it, that marijuana could potentially provide more jobs for United States citizens than manufacturing.
I think that's more in saying how little manufacturing.
Yeah, well, it's slow. It's been dying over the past 40 years.
Yeah, it's not exactly
been outsourced and stuff
creating
like that.
A lot.
Yeah. Well, we're gonna end on that high note, and we're gonna jump right into the main topic. All right, guys, we're going to jump right into the main topic. And this week we're going to be talking about President Trump's address to the nation or address to Congress that happened last week. You agreed with that point?
The whole freaking speech.
I swear, there were some points where I was looking at Paul Ryan, and I would love to have known what he was thinking. He was probably like, gosh,
Half of them have to be like, are we standing up again?
Dude, some of these people are like 70 years old, dude. Like,
they got a good leg workout.
Yeah. Well, Bernie Sanders didn't do much standing, so.
Well, neither did most Democrats.
Yeah. So we both think that this was, you know, we think that this was by far President Trump's best speech. Best address to the nation. He sounded the most presidential.
The bar was set pretty low.
Honestly, kind of was with some of his past speeches. But I think he did really well. And I think of any president, I think this speech was a very solid speech. That doesn't mean it was perfect. We're going to talk about that later. But first, we're going to run through some of the polling numbers of what Americans thought of his speech.
Yep. All right. So polling. This is according to which polling is this?
Blaze.com.
Blaze.com polling?
Yep.
Okay, so 57% of Americans said that they had a very positive reaction to the speech, where 21 said they had a somewhat positive reaction, 11 said a somewhat negative, and 10 a very negative reaction to the speech.
So that's almost 80% of people saying, 20% and 60% saying very positive, 60% and 20% saying somewhat positive. That's some high praise.
Yes.
There, that's pretty...
It's actually a CNN poll.
Oh, it's a CNN poll.
Yeah, the Blaze was just referencing a CNN
poll. Oh, okay.
But,
oh,
so,
well,
yeah.
This is fake then.
This is fake news. In addition to that, 69% said that Trump's proposed policies are leading the country in the right direction, as opposed to 26 saying they're headed in a wrong direction. So that's kind of interesting. An overwhelming majority think that his proposed policies will lead us in a good direction. That's kind of interesting.
Yeah.
I mean, this, again, is all – I mean, let's preface all this is polling. I mean, if you look at our election, I mean, I think the polling is pretty inaccurate sometimes. And so this is all taken with a grain of salt.
Yeah. But you can it's still good to know kind of what the polling is.
You want to keep going with them?
Yeah, I mean, some of the main ones. So I think, 69% that his proposed policies are moving in the right direction is something important. 72% agree that his economic ideas are in the right direction. I don't think so. I think some of them are, some of them aren't. That's interesting. 62% that think that his immigration policies are on the right track.
That's very interesting, because if you just looked around, you would assume that,
well, if you watch the mainstream media, you would assume that everyone thinks that he's racist.
Yeah. Much.
And then 64% agree with his tax policies. So lower taxes, obviously. I don't know why that number. I feel like that number should be higher, but whatever.
Yeah, I know, right? Well, no, because
I want to pay more.
We shouldn't
taxes.
Be getting taxed at all. We should just tax the 1%. You know?
Yeah, I agree.
More than they're already being taxed.
We should tax them 150% of the income. More
they
than
have
they
to pay.
They should owe extra money on.
They
top
don't
of
even
this
make
salary.
Money. They
yeah,
just,
exactly.
I'm down.
So yeah, so right now Trump's approval rating is sitting at about 44% according to Gallup, which
stellar.
Yeah, it doesn't sound that great, and honestly, because it's not that great. However, just kind of want to preference it. When you look at Democrats' approval rating and Republicans' approval rating, they're both sitting at right around 37%. So
both
right
lower.
Right now, everyone's, you know, if you're in the politics field, you're not that popular with Americans.
It's interesting, more people like Trump than Republicans.
More people
is that a correct thing we can infer from that?
What were you saying? More people
like Trump than Republicans. I mean, there must be people that aren't approval with Republicans, but are.
I think, yeah, I think that's safe to say. But I think it's also, I think a lot of these polls are, you know, based off of the gridlock going on in Congress and how they're like unable to work with each other, and people are ticked off that nothing's happening.
Yeah, it's very true.
Which is definitely a valid concern.
Yeah.
But let's run through some of the positives. Let's start off with some of the positive notes. I thought that him starting off right off the bat, he and, you know, his administration has been criticized relentlessly over, you know, being racist, not caring enough about Black lives and the Jewish. There's been destruction of Jewish cemeteries recently.
Yeah.
And, of course, his administration has been criticized by not doing enough. Which it's just kind of all ridiculous, but
he addressed those things specifically. He talked about wanting to be uniting against hate and evil and actually condemning it.
Yeah,
which apparently some people have a problem with. I don't know. I mean, that's one of those things that I feel like it should be unanimous, but unfortunately, you saw throughout the whole speech specific Democrats not standing
for things that all Americans should stand for. I mean, like when he was talking about,
they weren't standing and applauding. They weren't acknowledging that it was good.
Yeah,
and it was bad. But we'll talk about that more later. I also liked his. I liked what he specifically said about putting America first, mm-hmm. which I don't think a lot of people like to come out and say. But I feel like it just makes sense. Like, that's not to say that we aren't going to help other people, but our number one priority should be protecting our citizens and our people, and not protecting or putting the rights of anybody else above that.
Yeah, and because if you think about it logically, if every country puts the rights and the needs of their citizens first and then other people second, then, you know, all citizens of every nation would be looked after as a priority by their own country. It makes sense. It makes logical sense.
Yes. But I feel like it's sometimes not people. I mean, most people are like, no, we need to help bring the immigrants in, and they need to have jobs and stuff. And like, but the people that are already here that don't have jobs, we just don't care about them, or the veterans that come back and we don't do anything to really help.
Yeah.
It's this idea that we need to be helping everybody else, when in reality, I think we need to be building ourselves back up as well. And just watching out for one another, not necessarily bringing, like, I don't know. I thought it was cool and I liked it. And it was interesting because you don't usually hear that. Like, it's not something I've really heard a politician speak about.
The last 8 years, you definitely haven't heard it.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, no, I thought that was interesting to kind of play off that when he was talking about immigration, how he kind of introduced a merit-based system. I thought that was definitely interesting.
Yeah.
I like that.
And the fact that he was saying that he was looking at the way other countries doing it and trying to grab ideas, I think that's cool. I think that's good. Look at what's been successful. Look at what hasn't been successful in other places, and kind of, you know, take little bits and pieces here and there.
Yeah.
And the merit system sounds good to me. I mean, if you can come in here and prove that you're going to be beneficial to society, we'll let you in.
Exactly. If you can sustain yourself and come in, then, you know, that's fine.
That sounds – yeah. I mean, that doesn't necessarily work very well with refugees because they're just trying to get out. But for immigrants – I think that's a good idea.
Well, for people trying to come in, I definitely think that's a good idea. And like you talked about other countries doing, I mean, Canada does it, and people aren't calling Canada racist. Gosh.
Yeah. Also, I liked when he talked about his meeting with Trudeau and how they wanted that. Then they created a special committee to make sure women entrepreneurs have the same access to.
You like that?
Sources, like stuff to do, like money, people to talk to. What is that called?
Same opportunity. I thought it was pandering, really, because they already do have the same rights.
And well, abilities. I mean, but I think it's cool that, you have apparently, most feminists are going to tell you that he hates women, but the fact that he went out of his way to create this thing, and it's not just him creating, I don't think, the pander, because, I mean, Trudeau's been very big on this idea of equality and of breaking down the boundaries, because he hired a lot of women for his
boundaries
cabinet.
That don't exist.
Yeah, well, I don't know. I thought it was cool, and it's something that's nice that he mentioned. I mean, he could have just not mentioned it.
I mean, it gives him, it gives Democrats a reason to, like, almost have to stand and applaud for what he's saying, because there's no reason not to, really.
Except they found reasons.
As long as no legislation comes of it, then I'm fine with that.
I agree. Well, you also talked about that, right? For every new piece of legislation, there needs to be two being taken away.
Regulations. Yeah. He talked about that. I think that's great, man. We are so over – businesses and everything is so ridiculously over-regulated right now.
Yeah.
And take those off the economy. Let it actually grow. Don't constrict it so much. I think that was good. That was definitely good. I liked – what did you think of – so obviously kind of probably the most famous moment of his entire speech, and the thing that people are talking about is the two-minute standing ovation that we got when he recognized the widow of the fallen Navy SEAL, Ryan Owens. So what do you think, before we get into the reaction of the Democrats and how that makes Trump look and all that kind of stuff, what do you think about politicians basically using people for their own political gain? Do you think that's what he was doing? I don't know. What do you think about that?
I was actually going to bring that up because I don't want to say that he didn't care, and I do think it's great to acknowledge a fallen hero like that, because I think he was a hero serving his country. That's honorable. That's awesome. It was cool to see everyone stand up and give him a standing ovation. But it did seem, especially because of the people that he brought. Like, he brought a African-American or black woman that made it out of poverty and is now going to be the first in her family to graduate. He brought a mentally challenge woman that is going to be, she's at Harvard, I think, or somewhere.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He also brought a woman that lost a police officer. Her dad was a police officer.
Yep.
He brought her. And so it kind of, with so many, like if it was just the Navy SEAL, that would have been fine. But with so many that he kept pointing out, it started to feel like he was just kind of,
I think you could make an argument for some of them. I think two things, like we've talked about this before, two things can be true at once. I think he certainly could have been using her for political gain. But also, I'm sure that thought popped into his mind, like, yes, all these people are going to applaud. That's going to make me look good, and my message is going to look good. However, I sincerely do believe that Trump does care about our troops in the military. And I think that he honestly was, you know, trying to, because I think this widow, this poor lady is going to be, you could see she was obviously very upset and very disturbed, and she was looking up, you know, and all this during the whole thing. And I think that it's very cool that she's going to be able to show, you know, her children that, look, this, the entire country was applauding your father. He's such a hero. Look at the tape. We had probably one of the longest standing ovations in recent history, at least for me. I don't think that's a bad thing. I think that's a cool thing. Yeah. And especially when it's something I can see how you can politicize an agenda by bringing in a victim of like something that, controversial. Mm-hmm. I don't think that fallen war heroes should be controversial no matter what party you are. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
All parties that's should be very supporting true.
And I do think that he can also care about him and really revere, hold him up in reverence. And also understand that it would be a good political move.
Yeah.
You know, like,
yeah,
he could.
And I don't think there's necessarily something wrong with that. If it's.
And
if
especially because she was there. So she's smart enough to realize.
Yeah, that. She chose to be there too, obviously.
Exactly.
She
and so if she's okay with it, I think that's cool.
Yeah.
It
was a very touching moment, honestly.
It was.
Watching
it was very awesome.
And seeing it. It was.
It was
I thought that was a
good stand up because I mean they really hadn't stood up like the whole freaking time, dude. I was getting so tired. I have to jump in about that again, man. What is with the clapping and standing? It bothered me so much.
Every,
like, let him talk,
and then like one person would clap, and then he would stop, and then like everyone was like, "Okay, no, now we actually really have to clap." Yeah, no, it seems kind of awkward, but that's how they've always done it, man.
I would have loved to have been in the room and just like started to clap every
just
time.
Just starting to clap, and then someone, "Oh yeah, no, we're clapping now."
Yeah. And I, Donald Trump, just start clapping.
Yeah.
And everyone just
But I think the main thing, what made that, obviously it was a big moment for him and for her and stuff like that, but what made it such a big deal is that you saw, there's, of course, the famous picture taken where all the Republicans are standing up and like 70% of the Democrats are sitting down. Initially did stand.
Yeah, that's a little deceiving.
So
they
to say
stand.
That they did not stand at all is not true. However, after about, you know, I think I don't know the exact time. It's probably about 10 seconds. The majority of them, a lot of them started sitting down, and the standing ovation lasted for almost 2 minutes.
I didn't realize it was so long when I was watching
it. It's almost two minutes long.
I don't care who you are. Like, you should have stood for the whole 2 minutes. Like,
exactly. If you're a senator or a congressman, you know how politics is. Like, you know that this is something you should
be standing
for.
Well, they were trying to make a statement, probably, that they don't like Trump.
No, exactly. I've talked about this, but I think it's very clear that their statement was that they disliked Trump more than they respected him.
Yes.
And his service.
The military. And the fact that you can't separate policy from the person, like, you could stand for a policy you like and still don't like the person. Like,
yeah,
even if
absolutely.
You don't like Trump, you can respect that he did that for the war hero and stand up and applaud the war hero and just know that I am not applauding Trump. I am applauding what he did for my country. Or when Trump said things about unifying the country, I'm not standing up for Trump. I'm standing up for the idea of unification. I don't think Trump's doing it, but for that issue, I do believe in. And the fact that you can't separate the person from the policies and you just hate the person, so anything he says, I will just not stand up for, that's dangerous. Because
if
then
everyone
just
did what you just described, the world would be a much better place. The United States definitely would be.
It was very I think a lot of people, I saw this reported on a lot, it kind of made the Democrats look bad, you know?
Oh, it definitely made the Democrats
like grow up, you know?
Yeah, it definitely did. Because a lot of headlines coming out initially were that they didn't stand at all, and while that's not really true, it gave off the perception that they really didn't stand because the majority of the time they weren't standing. And most Americans are going to be like, why the heck wouldn't you stand for a Navy SEAL who died in the line of duty.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous. Yeah. So that was obviously a good moment for Trump, and I thought it was a good moment for him. You have any other good things that you wanted to get off before I have a couple things I disagreed with?
Yeah, let's just jump into the things that we didn't necessarily like.
Yeah.
Do you want to start with that?
Yeah, so with Trump's policies, I thought his speech itself was very good. I think that he delivered it well. His policies, I agree with about 70% probably of his policies. So there were a couple main ones that stood out for me. One, the $1 trillion stimulus package that he wants to do.
Yep, I have that written down too.
I don't like this at all.
And I mean, I like the idea of increasing our infrastructure, or not increasing, but improving, because our infrastructure is crap in a lot of ways.
Mm-hmm.
I agree.
It should be left up to the states, in my opinion. I don't think it should be. I think it should be left up to the states to figure out. It shouldn't be subsidized through the government, through the federal government.
Well, then you're going to have. I think that I would be okay with the government controlling that. But I think at this point, maybe we just work on not adding to the budget for a little bit.
I mean, why would you want to
show
add
that you're
going
to be cutting it at the same, at a bigger rate than you are adding to it?
Here's the thing. I mean, you can't. That's fine. If you take that stance, that's fine. But you can't criticize Obama when he wanted to do a $700 million stimulus, which basically every Republican was doing at that time. This is the worst thing. We're already $15 trillion in debt. Obama wants to add on another $700 million. Now when Trump says it, it's the greatest thing in the world.
But he didn't. It wasn't a stimulus. I mean, I'm specifically talking about the infrastructure rebuilding that he wanted to do.
Well, that's the same thing as what Obama
did. Well,
no.
I mean,
I
think saying that you're going to put money into rebuilding the infrastructure of America is different than saying, oh, all these car companies are failing. Here's millions of dollars. Hopefully you guys get better.
Yeah, but Obama also did a $700 million infrastructure stimulus package as well.
Okay, well, I would be okay with this then if I saw the fruits of
stimulus
package.
And it's basically, she's government trying to create jobs, which I don't agree with as a small government. Capitalist conservative. I don't think that's the government's role, so I don't like that. Also, we don't have the money to pay for it. And like you said, if he had talked about lowering the government budget, then it would be great, but he doesn't. The thing is, is he talks about reducing taxes, which I love. I'm all for that. But when you reduce taxes, you have to reduce spending because the government doesn't have that revenue. But he doesn't talk about that. He wants to increase spending.
Yeah,
so he talked about increasing the military budget, which for me is not a big deal.
I don't like that. I mean, yeah.
Seth thinks we're fine where we're at. We do spend more than, you know, the next 10 countries combined on our military. But if you're going to spend more on the military, you have to cut it somewhere else. And he's already said that he's not – well, no, this is what he said. He said that he's going to take it from the funding that we give other countries, which is less than 1% of our federal budget. So it's not enough to cover that one. And then two, he said that he's not going to – even cut Medicare, Medicaid, or Social Security, which makes up 60% of our budget. Mm-hmm. Which, if we don't touch that, we will go bankrupt. Like, if we continue on this course.
Well, I think we're already bankrupt.
Mega bankrupt? Is that a thing?
Super
Anyways,
ultra bankrupt.
This bothers me. I'm passionate about this, and it bothers me that people think that just because Trump says it, it's a good thing, or it's a conservative policy, or it's a small government policy. It's not. It's just not. And it's a stupid idea. Anyways,
I mean, you don't think there's a situation where it could be a small government policy?
No, the federal government spending $1 trillion will never be a small government.
Well, I'm not
policy.
Talking about the money. I'm just talking about them being in charge of improving infrastructure in the country.
No, government creating jobs is never a small government policy, in my opinion. I don't think so. And if government does create, if the government does need to step in and you know, spend money on roads and bridges and stuff like that, it should be left up to the state level to do that, and the communities within the state to raise the funds to provide the bridge for their community, and not the government taking a ton of money away from Georgia to go build a bridge in California. That's my opinion.
No, I would disagree there, but that's all right.
I also didn't
like the fact that he – I mean, I don't know if I'm necessarily 100% correct on this, but – he was taking credit for like a lot of things that I really just don't think he was responsible for.
The stock market.
Market, companies bringing back, making.
Yeah.
I was like, you have nothing. Like, these just happen to happen when you're in office.
Yeah, exactly.
And certain things were in play and being put into motion way before you were even running for the president. And just because they happen to happen when you're there, you get to take credit. I guess you get to, but
Yeah. Because, well, I mean, if Trump gets to take credit for the stock market, the Dow being at 21,000, then Obama gets to take credit from it being at, you know, around 669 in 2009 all the way up to it was at 19,000 yeah. when he left. So I don't know. I think that I agree with that. I agree with that.
Yeah.
Another one that bothered me was he talked about paid maternity and paternity leave. I don't like that either.
Yeah,
if you haven't already got the sense, I don't like when government steps in and forces businesses to do things or subsidizes individuals on the tax paradigm to do it.
And see, he's not saying there shouldn't be paid maternity leave. He's saying there shouldn't be government-funded paid maternity leave. You're saying private companies should be allowed to do that if they would like to.
Well, what he was essentially saying is that
I'm saying you specifically. Like, oh, you're not saying you're
I think if a company wants to, then that's fine. But the government should not mandate them to do it.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Just because some people hear would say, "Oh, you don't want people to have maternity leave." It's like, no, I do. No.
If they want to work for a company that provides that for them, that's fine. There's companies that do that. Not all of them, because it's not a smart thing to do, just business wise. And I think it's a perk. It's a perk if you want to do that. If you want to pay your employees a little bit less and then say, "Hey, but we cover this." You know, if you want to have a kid, we pay you off for your time leave. That's fine.
I mean,
that's
I
a
think
strategic
paid maternity
move.
Leave is a good thing. I do not think that the government should be footing the bill, though.
Yeah, no, absolutely not.
Unless it's like a government position, then that would make sense.
I still think that's dumb, but yeah. No, I mean, I think it's crazy. I think that the whole thing is the responsibility falls on the individual. If you don't have enough money saved up to take off some time to have a child, then don't have a child yet. Save up more money and don't expect the taxpayer to cover your lack of responsibility. And your lack of planning.
No.
That's my two cents. All right.
I don't think that's so, but that's fine.
You don't think that someone should save up money and plan to have a child before they have a baby?
No, I don't think you're saying if someone takes off from a work and then likes that their job is paying them maternity leave, that then they're
I'm saying that they should. A lot of proponents of maternity leave want to force businesses to pay.
I'm against that, but yeah, I'm saying private companies. I mean,
companies can, but I'm just saying.
I think if you worked for the government, then that would make sense as well for the government to pay for it, because who else is going to pay for it? And I do think that paid leave is important, because I don't think it's smart or makes any sense.
Well, paid leave from the government, you realize, is just taxpayers paying for them.
Yeah, I know, but I'm already paying for their job, and if it's a necessary job, I'm assuming that it's a necessary job. And
that's
not
an assumption, for sure.
Well, but, yeah, I know, but I mean, in the ideal world, if we had a small government and we had, for instance, just super basic, we had 10 people working the front offices of the Pentagon or something, and one of them had a kid, that would make sense for us to cover them. Like, that would make sense to me.
I will support that policy if we have 10 people working.
Right? 10 people,
Pentagon.
That's right.
You can be off the entire year and I'll pay for it. That's fine.
Yeah, right? I also, I don't know if you caught this, though, but he said that when he was talking about bringing companies in, he said he's like, he wants to make it welcoming for companies to come in and they feel like they should come here. But then he also said he wants it to make it harder for companies to leave our country.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
I don't like that.
Yeah.
That was a little weird. I don't necessarily know what that means, but it didn't sound good to
me
personally.
Well, his whole premise behind that is he doesn't want American companies to leave.
Yeah, but to say that he's going to make it harder to leave?
Yeah, well, no, I don't agree with this at all. I think it's stupid. Yeah. That falls under, and I wrote this down too, it falls under his fair trade, not free trade thing. Yeah. He talks about that a lot. He wants fair trade, but he cares more about free trade. So, and that's kind of that whole thing where, I mean, and also, he said he wants it to be welcoming for companies to come in and import things in, but then he talks about tariffs. So that's not a welcoming policy for companies. It's just not. Like, I don't know.
A little bit of contradiction.
It's not
going
to incentivize people to import their goods here or to export their goods here if we tariff them. So I don't know. It's kind of – I don't agree with him on that front. Mm-hmm. I agree with the whole – I like the idea of, you know, buying American and hiring American when it makes sense for your company.
Yeah.
I'm 100% for that. But if it doesn't make sense and you're going to potentially have to cut back as a company, lay off some people and cut people's hours back because you're deciding to buy American, then that doesn't pay off in the long run when you look at people's jobs and the hours and the money that they make. So,
yeah. I don't know. That's all I had written out.
That was pretty much it for me. And like I said,
a lot of mine were very minor things, like little things I heard him say that I was like, I'm not on board with that. But in general, I agree with you. I think it was his best speech
yeah.
by far. No fake news, no calling CNN fake news.
Yeah.
No.
It was a unifying speech, really. I mean, it was a patriotic speech. It was pretty unifying. And I harp on these things because they're important to me. And I always focus on, you know,
the criticisms.
Yeah, the bad things. Like I said before, I agree with a good bit of his policies and stuff like that. And I thought this was a good speech and this was a high moment for him.
And yeah, it was interesting. You saw a lot of people coming forward and saying, even people on both sides saying that this was definitely his best speech. You actually had Van Jones.
Yeah, Van Jones coming out.
Saying that he became the president in this speech, which, I mean, I really don't care what Van Jones has to say.
He became the president on January 20th, but, you know, whatever.
Well, no, he wasn't my president. Like, now.
Yeah, oh, yeah, now he's his president.
It's settled, yeah. It's
yeah,
settled,
no, so I thought it was good. Good for Trump, and just don't tweet anything for a little while. Don't tweet anything for a little while. Just let this ride out.
I know, right?
But with that, guys, we're going to go ahead and finish up in our main topic, and we're going to jump right into what triggered us this week. All right, guys, we are back with what triggered us this week, and this is the place where we retreat to the moon and we throw rocks at our adversaries. And if you don't get that, you will in a couple of seconds.
It's probably unnormal that you don't get that.
If you don't get that, then that's probably a good thing. But Seth, why don't you jump into it first, man?
All right. So this week, it's gonna hurt a little bit. Not really. It's funny. So it makes me laugh. I love Harry Potter, as I talked about a lot. I mean, I have a wand right up there on the wall. I love it. I love the writing. I've not necessarily been so much a fan of J.K. Rowling's Twitter lately. It's been quite annoying with the PewDiePie situation and then fascism and calling people Nazis, whatever. She's also been very outspoken about immigration and how the Muslim ban that happened here, she was very outspoken against it and how she didn't like it. But thankfully, a petition was started. And as we all know, petitions are the way to get things done, you know? So at this point, there has been 55,000 signatures to this petition. What does this petition do, you might ask? Well, it is a petition for J.K. Rowling to house 18 immigrants in her 18 spare bathrooms.
Wow.
Bedrooms, not bathrooms. I think it's so funny because she talks about how she wants immigration. So someone started this petition. It's a joke. It's funny. It's not obviously no one is really asking her to do this, but they're just kind of addressing that she has 18 spare bedrooms across her home.
It's kind of hypocritical.
Yeah, exactly. And so the best part is at the end of this, you can go. We're going to link in the description the petition should you want to sign. But the funniest part to me is at the end of this petition, and here's what it reads. It says, "We demand that J.K. Rowling grant no less than 18 refugees shelter in her mansions for at least 8 years. She rejects safe immigration, which is why we also demand that there will be no additional vetting process for these refugees.
Sounds good,
her
man.
Virtue signaling stems from ignorance, and the 100% effective cure of it will be this drastic change of perspective. To make this group of refugees representative of the situation in Europe, we also demand that this group consists of 14 men and 4 women, because 75% of the millions of refugees are male."
This is great, man.
It's so good, bro. It's so funny. And it's showing the hypocrisy. And I mean, I understand that letting an immigrant into your home is different than wanting countries to bring them in. I understand that. It's a joke. It was funny. It made me laugh. And I don't know. I think it's awesome.
Hysterical.
And 55,000 people signed it. That's insane.
That's a lot of people, man.
Awesome.
It's once we reference it, dude, we're gonna get it up to 100,000.
It's gonna be at like 53,000.
Drop.
What triggered you this week, Jared?
Yeah, so mine was of course in reference to the moon. This is great, man. I think this is awesome. So a Democratic candidate who's running to be congresswoman in Massachusetts, her name is Brianna Wu, and she actually well might win. And so this is what she tweeted. She was very upset about SpaceX. Okay. So she tweeted this out. She said, hold on. Let me preface this first. SpaceX announced that they were going to be doing commercial trips around the moon or taking people into.
In 2018, they wanted one commercial trip with 2 people around the moon to be successful.
There you go. So if you didn't know that, you learned something today. So she was upset and she tweeted this out and she goes, "This is being covered as a fun hijink for rich people. But the idea of a private corporation having access to the moon should give pause. Then she continues and says, the moon is probably the most tactically valuable military ground for Earth. Rocks dropped from there have the power of hundreds of nuclear bombs. Yeah. I love this, man. I hope that she gets in, because Congress would be a lot less boring. You know what I mean? Like, they're going to be talking about, like, military strikes and stuff, and she just stands up and like is like, hold on,
with
guys.
With an umbrella? And she's like, why do you have an umbrella? Rocks.
Yeah, and she'll just be like, wait, guys, hold on. Forget the invasion. Let's just send someone up to the moon, kick a rock off, and just take ISIS out.
Because we don't understand how physics work.
Oh, you mean you can't just drop a rock from the moon and the atmosphere won't burn it up and it won't, like... That's
you
not gonna
drop
happen.
The moon, maybe.
Yeah, right. Yeah. I just love this, man. The fact that she
the
might
thought
win.
Process, like, not, oh my gosh, it's so cool, we're gonna have people flying around the moon. It's like, no, it's a tactical military.
No,
like,
people
no.
drop rocks there all the time, and they
when
have
was the last
forces
time
of
the moon?
Hundreds
it's been
of
decades.
Let me just hold on. So rocks dropped from there have the power of hundreds of nuclear bombs. Hundreds of nuclear bombs would destroy the entire planet. So this has never happened before.
Well, no, we had the one rock with the dinosaurs, but that was it, and it did
there you
kind
go.
Of blow.
Hundreds of nuclear. It's had the power of hundred nuclear bombs.
Yeah, I mean, why do we even need to stockpile nuclear bombs? Let's just
we have
stockpile
the moon.
Rocks. You know what
yeah,
I'm saying?
We had the moon. We were there first, man. We should be able to knock the rocks off, man. I love this. So, anyways, I hope she gets in. Honestly, I really do. I really do. It would be. Great.
I want to know where she got her calculations for hundreds of nuclear bombs and a rock. So what's a pebble? Like one nuclear bomb?
Yeah, just one.
Just one? Okay.
Yeah. Atmospheres don't exist, by the way.
Oh, good. Oof, and gravity is also not a thing to get it outside of the freaking moon.
Yes, yes. Well, that's going to bring us to our booming conclusion of this week's podcast, guys. If you like this podcast, guys, as always, like our video, subscribe to our YouTube channel. That really helps us out. If you don't have time to watch us, then check us out on your favorite podcasting service. We're on iTunes and Google Play. Be sure and leave a review there. That also helps us out. That would be awesome. Guys, we will see you next week. And as always, stay informed.